Hello friends, welcome to the module of fluid and electrolyte management in neonatology. Divided this topic in four parts. The first part I would be talking about basics of fluid therapy in neonatology. The second part Dr. Palak Jain would be talking about the different composition of the fluids which we use in day-to-day life. The third part would be called by Dr. Aarti Rajan, so it will be on sodium imbalance seen in neonatology. And the fourth part I would be talking about the potassium imbalance in neonates. So let us go ahead with the first talk, that is basics of fluid therapy in neonatology. We all are aware that maintaining fluid balance is extremely essential for normal cell and organ function. The various complex mechanisms regulate the fluid balance in the body. Pathologic conditions like ductus arteriosus, sepsis, bronchopulmonary dysplasia, and so on disrupts these complex regulatory mechanisms and cause disturbance in the fluid balance in the body. Now, we have to know the basic physiological needs of the babies in different situations, the disease as well as non-disease status, so as to provide appropriate fluid therapy as per the need. So, just the basics of fluid compartmentalization. This is the total body composition. And you can see that the total body composition is compartmentalized in two major parts. One is solids and then second is fluids. Now you can see that the solids is in gray shade and the fluid is in pink or red, whatever shade you say, that in that shade. And the fluid compartment forms the major part of the body composition. Now, as you can see here, the fluid compartment is divided into two parts. One is intracellular water compartment and the extracellular water compartment. As the name suggests, when I say intracellular fluid or water compartment, it means that it's a fluid which is there in the cell, which forms the compartment of the intracellular fluid compartment. And the fluid which is outside the cell forms the compartment of extracellular fluid. Now, the extracellular fluid compartment, as you can see here, is composed of two parts. One is interstitial fluid compartment and intravascular volume compartment. Plasma forms a major component of intravascular volume compartment. We also know that the amount of total body water as a percentage of body weight and its distribution in various fluid compartments varies with gestation age. Now you can see this, you can compare these three figures here. The first is a fetus at 16 weeks of life. The second is a newborn, just newborn baby at term gestation age. And third is an infant at 3 months of age. You can see the differences in color shades in these three babies. So the dark blue color is actually a water compartment. A light blue shade is a non-water or a solid compartment. If you compare head to toe, then you can see that with the advancement of gestation age, you can see that the water compartment is decreasing, right? And the solid compartment is increasing. Now, the solid compartment keeps on increasing is because of the accretion of the solids in the form of protein, fat, and carbohydrate. You can also see that the intracellular water compartment, that is in light blue shade, keeps on increasing with the increasing gestation age, and the extracellular water compartment keeps on decreasing with the increasing gestation age. Why it is important? One, if we know this, then the fluid management becomes easy. We know the physiological needs of the baby. Second, we know that if a baby is born at 28, 29 weeks of gestation, compared to term gestation age baby, this baby is going to have more of extracellular water compartment. Hence, tight fluid balance, preventing insensible water loss becomes extremely essential in that particular baby. Okay. Now, this shuffling in fluid continues post-birth, and preterm neonates have been shown to undergo three different phases of sodium and water changes based on day of life. The first is prediuretic phase, which is generally seen from birth to the first day of life, and it is generally characterized by oliguria. The urine output is generally around 1 ml per kg per hour, maybe just below that. The second phase is diuretic or natriuretic phase, which characteristically starts by day 2 and day 3 of life, and it is characterized by increase in both urine output and sodium losses. So In this phase, it is also said that the lung fluid is absorbed and there is improvement in lung condition. Specifically, this you may have heard during rounds that the baby is a day two, day three. Baby is going to start with the diuresis and the baby's lungs may improve. So this is a typical example of that. The third phase is post-diuretic phase, which is generally seen on day four, day five. And it is characterized by varied urine output depending upon changes in fluid intake compared with the second and third day of life. Yeah. So we all know that the babies lose weight post-birth, and because of this shuffling in the body fluid and diuresis, they lose weight. So term babies generally lose around 5 to 10% of weight by 7 to 10 days of life, and premature babies may lose up to 15% of weight by approximately 10 to 14 days of life. So the weight gain generally starts in term babies by 7 to 10 days, and in premature babies, the weight gain starts by 14 to 21 days. Small gestation age babies, because there is disturbance in body water compartment, generally have different kind of weight loss pattern, and maybe the weight loss is seen in is not seen that great with the small for gestation age or IUGR baby. It has been said that it could be because of the adaptation to altered dynamics. There are other factors also which influence water and electrolyte homeostasis. That one is kidney. Because of the developmental immaturity of the kidneys in terms of glomerular filtration, as well as urine concentrating ability and tubular reabsorption of sodium, bicarbonate, and secretion of potassium and hydrogen, this influences the body composition of the specifically premature babies, and accordingly, based on the needs, we need to prescribe fluids in the premature babies. We all are aware, we've been learning, the skin of the preemies is extremely immature, and specific skin care needs to be taken because skin contributes to major insensible water loss, which needs to be balanced when we prescribe the fluid therapy. Same with the respiratory tract. Increasing rate of the respiration as well as delivery of non-humidified oxygen or the gases is going to cause insensible water loss. So utmost care should be taken when you manage a premature baby, specifically paying attention towards these three handicaps of the premature babies. So hence, whenever fluids are prescribed to neonates, allow physiological postnatal contraction during early days of life. Also, please remember that one size does not fit all. Understand the underlying physiological need or disease process and accordingly individualize the prescription. So once we understand the basic physiology, when do we start IV fluids? Which babies do need IV fluids? So fluids are the cornerstone of the treatment in babies who cannot be fed. This is basic principle. And those who you start feeds, but they are likely to reach their full amount of feeds in next few days, right? And the typical these babies are premature and the premature low weight babies as well as the sick babies. So generally indications of starting IV fluids are preterm babies less than 32 weeks of gestation, birth weight of less than 1.5 kg, and sick neonates irrespective of their gestation age. Now this gestation age and birth weight criteria what I have mentioned here may change from unit to unit. It may not be the same in every unit. So when we calculate, now for this, once we know the indication of IV fluids, then how do we go about? Okay, so total fluid intake is generally calculated based on the maintenance fluid requirement of that particular baby, the deficit what that baby has, and the ongoing losses. So all these three things are considered when you calculate a total fluid intake. How do we calculate maintenance of fluid requirements? So by taking into account insensible water loss, sensible water loss, and water required for tissue growth, combining all these three, we reach a maintenance fluid requirement of a particular baby. So what are insensible water losses? Insensible water losses are the water loss which is not easily measurable, and these are free water losses occurring through the skin and the respiratory tract. Sensible water loss is a free water loss through the urine and feces. which is easily calculable, right? You know the urine output and you know exact number. You know the amount of stool baby has passed and you know the exact number, right? Water is retained in new tissue during growth and it is generally 10 to 20 ml per kg per day. So generally in neonates, urine output is the most important source of sensible water loss. And based on the gestation age and clinical condition, the insensible water, if you see a preemie baby, then the major component of insensible water loss is the skin and then the respiratory tract. What are the factors affecting this insensible water loss? Level of maturity. More is the immature baby, more is insensible water loss due to delicate skin, right? We've seen that. Respiratory distress, increasing respiratory rate, increasing insensible water loss. Environmental temperature above thermoneutral zone, the loss is going to be high. If there's a skin breakdown, again, the loss is going to be high. If the baby is cared under open care system, that is radiant warmer, or if the baby is receiving phototherapy, if the baby is excessively crying, excessively fidgety, then the chances of insensible water loss are high. What are the intervention we can do to prevent this insensible water loss? So you increase the ambient humidity of the incubator from 20 to 80%. This will decrease the insensible water loss by 75%. Using a plastic shield also help in decreasing the insensible water loss. Using a semi-permeable membrane, topical agents, minimal handling, taking good care of skin, avoiding breakdowns. So these all can decrease the insensible water loss. So control the environment when you take care of the preemies. Take utmost care of the skin. Use heated humidified gas for babies needing respiratory support to prevent the insensible water loss. When a neonate is been prescribed IV fluids, one should aim at urine output of 1 to 3 ml per kilo per hour, urine specific gravity of 1.005 to 1.015, daily weight loss of 1 to 3% of body weight, plasma osmolality of 270 to 285 milliosmoles per kg, absence of edema or dehydration, maintenance of euglycemia, euniteremia, and eukalemia. So do we have to calculate this every time? No, it is not needed. However, you need to have a charting and proper monitoring sheet where every fluid, whatever you're giving, is reviewed every 4 to 6 hourly or based on the unit policy. So how do we calculate, just an example, how do we reach a fluid requirement of 60 to 70 ml per kilo per day for a term baby? A full-term infant on IV fluids would need to excrete a solute load of 15 milliosmoles per kilogram per day in the urine. Now to excrete this solute load at a urine osmolarity of 300 milliosmoles per kilogram per day, the neonate would have to pass minimal amount of urine of approximately 50 ml per kilo per day. So as per our formula of maintenance plus losses, now this baby is going to have insensible water loss of approximately 20 ml per kilo per day. So if I calculate the total fluid intake, it is the losses, sensible losses, insensible water loss. So that is 50 plus 20, that is 70 ml per kilo per day. The initial fluids for term baby is generally a 10% dextrose with no additives, and the glucose infusion rate should be maintained around 4 to 6 milligrams per kilogram per minute. The fluid requirements in ml per kilo per day are approximately as shown in the table here. Kindly note that these are general guidelines for starting maintenance on the day of admission. Ideally, advances in fluids are to be made based on the assessment of the fluid status of each baby. So you can see here, if the baby is less than 1 kg, I would start fluids of around 100 ml per kilo per day. 1 to 1.5 kg, 80 ml per kilo per day. More than 1.5 kg, 60 ml per kilo per day. Now every day, the increase in fluid requirement is around 20 ml per kilo per day, reaching maximum up to 150 ml per kilo per day. Beware, these are just a rough guidelines. However, this may change based on the underlying baby's condition. How do we start electrolytes and how much and when? So dextrose is generally started in babies on day one. So the aim is not to give 5% dextrose or 10% dextrose. The aim is you monitor baby's blood glucose level, and the dextrose with the glucose infusion rate of 4 to 6 milligram per kg per minute is the goal. So generally it is achieved by giving 10% dextrose for more than 1 kilo babies and 5% dextrose in less than 1 kg baby. However, if the baby is hypoglycemic, we need to adjust the percentage of dextrose based on the baby's need. If the baby is hypoglycemic, you need to adjust the percentage of dextrose based on the level of hypoglycemia. The sodium and potassium generally is added in IV fluids after 48 hours. Sodium is added in a dose of 3 milliequivalents per kilo per day. Potassium is added in the dose of 2 milliequivalents per kilo per day. Calcium is generally added on day one in certain high-risk babies, that is premature, asphyxiated, and based on the baby's condition in infant or diabetic mothers. How much do we add? 4 to 8 ml per kilo per day of 10% calcium gluconate. Now, additional allowances may be required under certain circumstances, and these are applicable more to very preterm babies. What are these additional allowances? So based on the level of insensible water loss, you increase the fluid intake. So if the baby is under open care system, that is radiant warmer, you may have to increase the fluid intake by 20 ml per kilo per day. That is, baby receiving phototherapy, baby's need increases by 20 ml per kilo per day. The baby has temperature or fever, the need may go by increase by 10 to 20 ml per kilo per day. So you take into consideration everything when you take care of preemies, and then accordingly you balance the fluid intake. So this is a table which is showing the replacement to be given when there are pathological losses. So volume by volume replacement is needed in addition to maintenance fluids in situations like urinary losses, that is polyuria, vomiting, when there are huge NG aspirates, diarrheal losses, chest tube drainage, or third space loss. Now here we mentioned, when are we supposed to replace these fluids, how frequently one needs to replace, and what kind of replacement fluid to be used. So you'll get this presentation. So these are the specific things. This chart has to be there in NICU so that there is no confusion in replacing fluid. Now the specific fluid which is used for replacing these losses is based on the composition of the losses. So urine losses, has different composition in terms of electrolytes compared to the diarrheal losses, right? So based on that, the fluid composition of the replacement fluid composition will vary. Growing preterm and term babies generally need a total fluid requirement of around 120 to 150 ml per kilo per day. It may go as high as 180 ml per kilo per day. And this is because with the increasing postnatal age and increasing enteral feedings, they have increasing renal solute load, and to excrete the renal solute load, the urine losses are also high. Same with the fecal losses. And plus, with the insensible water loss, the whole composition or the entire requirement comes around 120 to 150 ml per kilo per day. Slide on something called restrictive versus liberal water intake. No, because I can give fluids, it doesn't mean that I keep on giving fluid because the mother is worried about the weight gain and I want to increase weight. No, because the liberal fluid as well as the giving less fluid, both have certain good effect as well as side effect. Now, there's a meta-analysis which was published by Bell in 2010. What they said that if you restrict the fluids for preemies, the weight loss was significant in babies who were in restricted fluid group. When I'm saying restricted fluid means the fluids compared to the liberal group were given less. How much less? They were given 30 to 40 ml per kilo per day less. Okay, so these babies were at risk of dehydration. However, the risk of PDA, necrotizing enterocolitis, bronchopulmonary dysplasia, intraventricular hemorrhage, and death was seen on lower side in the restrictive fluid strategy compared to the liberal fluid strategy. So they concluded saying that fluid therapy needs to be balanced enough to meet the normal physiological needs without allowing significant dehydration. Okay, so we have to, basically this can be done by monitoring the fluid intake on an hourly basis and reviewing your fluid strategy every 6 to 8 hours. So how do we assess fluid status? This is extremely important. Now, if I go on leave and on day 8, I suddenly come and I tell them, that why are you starting this fluid? No, I have to know what gestation is the baby is, what is the birth weight, what is the how much is the weight loss, what is the baby's clinical condition, whether the baby has underlying any illness, what's the output baby is having, what's the intake baby has taken, and if there are any medications like furosemide, or aldactone, which can affect the baby's fluid balance. So without knowing the history of baby, managing fluids becomes difficult. Can we use clinical signs to determine the fluids intake of the baby? So generally, clinical signs are not very sensitive indicators in neonates. Like in pediatric population, altered skin turgor, sunken anterior fontanelle, dry mucous membrane are not sensitive indicators of dehydration. Also, babies will manifest with tachycardia, hypertension, metabolic acidosis only when the babies get moderate to severely dehydrated. Edema won't appear early. It will start appearing in presacral area first and then gradually progressing to all over the body. So it is also not an early marker of volume overload. So what can we do? So you have a chart, bedside chart, to know what you, how you're doing with the fluid management of that particular baby. So one needs to clinically assess the baby every 6 to 8 hourly for the signs of fluid deficit or fluid overload. Okay, if you do not see any signs of fluid deficit or fluid overload, you're doing well, right? Weight needs to be checked. We check once a day, but if the clinical condition allows and if the fluid management is extremely essential and every hourly it needs to be changed, then maybe once, twice in a day, weight can also be checked. The allowance for weight loss in first week is around 1-2% per day for a term babies and 2-3% for days for premature baby. The baby is losing more than 2% of the weight, then there is a fluid deficit. Okay, then our fluids need review. If the fluid deficit is more than 3% for a premature baby, it needs to be reviewed. If there is unexpected weight gain, I do not expect a preemie to gain weight by day 2 or day 3. Mm-hmm. And this baby starts gaining it, I will first ensure that the weight gain is actually there or not, whether there is any fault of weighing machine or not. Are there any signs of fluid overload in the baby or not? And if there is any sign or if there is a surety that the baby has gained fluid, gained weight, then I would revise my fluid strategy in that particular baby. Sodium, one needs to strictly maintain between 130 to 145 milligram equivalents per liter. If your sodium levels are more than 145, we know that the baby is having dehydration. And generally in fluid overloaded babies, there's hyponatremia. Okay, so generally sodium electrolytes are done after 48 hours and then based on the baby's clinical situation, you may repeat the sodium electrolytes. Because here we are going to balance the fluid, the sampling as well as the blood loss. So the clinical condition of the baby is extremely important and based on that investigation would depend. Strict urine output monitoring, very important. It should be monitored every 8th hour. You can monitor it by weighing the diaper or maybe catheterizing the baby if the baby is sick. Specifically, if the baby has kidney injury, catheterization becomes extremely essential because here a drop by drop urine, drop of every urine quantifying becomes important. Urine specific gravity can also be done. And if the specific gravity would be more in case if the baby is dehydrated, it would be low if the baby is overloaded, right? Creat would be high if the baby is dehydrated. However, blood urea nitrogen would be disproportionately high compared to the creat when the baby is dehydrated, telling you that this baby needs fluids. Okay, so this is just a basic assessment or monitoring chart when you decide fluid therapy for a neonate. So coming to the end, my take-home message would be fluid electrolyte management is the cornerstone of neonatal intensive care. Appropriate management requires an understanding of the physiologic principles and careful monitoring of the key data. Requirements vary substantially from neonate to neonate and in the neonate over time. Therefore, fluid prescription must be individualized and frequently assessed. Primary goal are maintain the appropriate extracellular fluid volume and ionic concentrations, that is sodium, potassium, and chloride. Thank you.
A very good day to everyone. Today we will be discussing about sodium imbalance in the newborns. I will be covering low sodium levels and high sodium levels. So the normal serum sodium levels are between 135 to 145 milliequivalents per liter or millimoles per liter. Now, by definition, hyponatremia means a serum sodium of less than 135 milliequivalents per liter. Now, commonly if you see in the NICU, a serum sodium of more than 125 patients generally is asymptomatic and does not have symptoms. A serum sodium of less than 125, baby will present with symptoms like apathy, lethargy, decreased activity, apnea, malaise, seizures, and coma. As a dictum, we treat hyponatremia when the serum sodium level is less than 130 milliequivalents per liter. Now, hyponatremia may be due to a number of reasons. It is usually due to large sodium losses through the kidneys in a preterm baby, or the use of diuretics, or dehydration, or renal failure, or SIADH. But for management of hyponatremia, we have to classify it, see if the baby has seizures and is in encephalopathy or is not. If the baby has seizures, then we have to use 3 to 5 ml per kg of 3% saline, and it has to be given over half an hour. At the same time, we have to look for other causes of convulsions and treat the convulsions as well. Now, if the baby is not in encephalopathy and is not in seizures, then we have to decide if the baby is euvolemic or in fluid overload or is dehydrated. If the baby is euvolemic or in fluid overload, then we have to use half to two-third maintenance fluids. We use 0.9% DNS, or we may continue enteral feeding as well. If the baby is dehydrated and if the serum sodium is between 130 and 134, ORS or 0.9 DNS may be used. If the serum sodium is less than 130, give 0.9% DNS according to the grade of dehydration. Very often in the NICU, in our unit, we give oral correction as well. This is done if serum sodium is more than 125 and otherwise the baby is well and is on full feeds. Now we use concentrated Ringer's lactate solution for this, and we add this to the oral feeds. 1 cc of Concarel contains approximately 3 milliequivalents of sodium. So the formula which is used is weight into 0.6 into 135 minus the sodium level of the baby. So this would give us the total milliequivalents we had to correct in 24 hours. This volume of Concarel is added to the feeds. It is divided in all the feeds so that the sodium gets corrected. Now, another dictum to be followed is you have to correct only around 12 milliequivalents per day. Even though the calculation shows more sodium to be corrected, please do not correct. Correct only 12 milliequivalents per day. Next, we come to hypernatremia. This is also commonly seen in newborns, especially in the summer months and breasts, and in those babies who are completely breastfed and breast milk is inadequate. So typically the baby presents with not feeding, tremendous weight loss, and the following signs and symptoms. Baby may be lethargic, restless, there may be hyperreflexia, there is spasticity, there may be convulsions, and typically the skin is dry, parched, and has a doughy feel. Now, hypernatremia is divided into mild, moderate, and severe. Mild hypernatremia is defined as a serum sodium between 146 to 149 milliequivalents per liter. Moderate hypernatremia is serum sodium between 150 and 169 milliequivalents per liter. And severe hypernatremia is serum sodium more than 170 milliequivalents per liter. Now, management of hypernatremia, I think, is the most challenging and difficult treatment when you compare to all the electrolyte imbalances in a newborn. So let us see, what do we do for mild hypernatremia? So luckily, if the sodium is between 146 to 149, the relatives have really come with the baby early to you. So just giving adequate maintenance feeds, ensuring good feeding, maybe formula feeds if necessary, if breast milk is inadequate, and if necessary, IV fluids maintenance, that is, would do the job. And the baby would gradually normalize his sodium levels. Now, if there is moderate or severe hypernatremia, it is a really challenging part. Very often, there are lots of formulas in different textbooks which are very complicated, but the easiest one has been given in Nelson textbook of pediatrics, and the simplest one of all is use 0.45 DNS for correction and give maintenance, and in addition 20 to 30% more than maintenance for the baby, and this you correct over 24 to 48 hours. The other formulas are, you give maintenance fluid plus deficit. Now, this deficit is calculated as 3 to 4 ml of water per kg for each 1 MEQ that the current serum sodium level exceeds 145. In our unit, we follow the Nelson formula and we have got good results, and it is very easy for all our doctors and the nurses to manage the hypernatremia. During the management of hypernatremia, there are goals which you have to keep in mind. You must not decrease sodium by less than 10 to 12 MEQ per liter every 24 hours. The rate of sodium drop should not be more than 0.5 MEQ per liter per hour. Because this sudden drop in sodium, what happens is it avoids excess delivery of free water, so that seizures and rapid fluid shifts are avoided. The serum sodium levels must be monitored very, very frequently, that is 6 hourly. And you will have to change your fluid every 6 hours according to what your serum sodium level is. If the serum sodium drop is fast, then you will use a different strategy. If it is slow, or if it is according to the need, you will continue with the same fluid management. Now, during the treatment of hypernatremia, if the baby has convulsions, it is because of sudden hypernatremia, and you have to manage by giving 3% saline at 3 to 5 ml per kg over half an hour. Because this sudden sodium drop and convulsions will lead to long-term neurological problems in the baby. Thank you.
Hello, friends. So we are here at the last part of the module, that is management of potassium imbalance. Now we all know that the electrolytes are little difficult and difficult to understand. So I have tried to make it case based, and what one needs to do once you see your potassium balance in NICU, what basic bedside management should be done. So that's what we are going to discuss here. So just an introduction, that we all know that the potassium is an important electrolyte of the body, and it is always denoted as K plus. Plus is an electric charge. It has a role of maintaining cell membrane potential, which is extremely important for the normal function of the vital organs, that is heart, brain, as well as the muscle contractility. Normal potassium level, which is maintained in the body, is 3.5 to 5.5 millicoulombs per liter. And the levels up to 6 milligrams per liter can be accepted in a newborn. Let us start with the case. The first case, this is a male baby referred at 32 weeks of gestation. Baby had respiratory distress syndrome, recessive factor 3 Ensure technique. The baby was started on feeds, and on day 3, day 4 of life, baby had increasing respiratory distress, was diagnosed to have ductus arteriosus and was receiving treatment for the same. However, the baby's ductus did not respond to the treatment, and for decongestion, the diuretic treatment was started. The baby was on furosemide for over the last 10 to 14 days. On day 21 of life, baby was noticed to have abdominal fullness with sluggish bowel sounds, and there were occasional episodes of bradyarrhythmias, which were noted on auscultation. The differentials which were kept in this particular baby were feeding intolerance, necrotizing enterocolitis, and sepsis. Routine investigations were done. Abdominal X-ray showed dilated bowel loops, no nematosis, most likely paralytic ideas. Septic screen was negative. Sodium was 135 millicoulomb per liter. Potassium was 2.5. So what is the diagnosis? The only abnormality here you can see is potassium, which is 2.5 millicoulomb per liter. And we know the normal range of potassium, that is 3.5 to 5.5 millicoulombs per liter. So this baby has hypokalemia. Hypo means low, kalemia is potassium. So this baby has low potassium. And the ECG was done. The ECG showed characteristic U wave. Okay, so the U wave is a positive wave after T. So this baby also had ECG findings. The other presentation in hypokalemia patient could be muscle weakness, paralysis, cardiac arrhythmias as seen in this patient, and polyuria. What could be the reason in this particular patient for hypokalemia? Either this baby has decreased intake of potassium, or this baby has increased losses, or there is increased intracellular movement of potassium from the extracellular compartment. Now, we know the history. What is the likely reason in this particular patient? This particular patient is on diuretic treatment for a long time. So, likely this baby is losing potassium through the kidney. What's next? We know the patient. We know the problem. Now, we have to treat hypokalemia. And during treatment, we also want to monitor for the complications and treat the cause. Bedside management, what it involves is strict vital monitoring and ECG monitoring. This baby has arrhythmia. This baby is likely to develop arrhythmia during treatment. And ECG monitoring becomes extremely important in this particular case. So a patient who is symptomatic and has hypokalemia, IV correction is given. A patient who are asymptomatic, then oral correction is enough. But once we decide whether we are going to go for symptomatic or asymptomatic correction, which formulation to be used, what dose to be used, and what to monitor. So there has to be written policy for hypo and hypokalemia. When you manage hypo and hypokalemia, there are a lot of potassium formulations which are available, that is potassium chloride, potassium phosphate, potassium citrate, potassium acetate. Potassium chloride is universally available in all units. Potassium phosphate is available in few units. So why is it important that which formulation you have in your unit is because every formulation is going to have different potassium composition. Hence, the policy of every nurse working in unit or every doctor working in unit should know what potassium preparation they have in the unit, because the prescription, whenever it's an emergency majority times or major times, it's just the dose is told. Potassium, sister potassium, itna do. Okay, it is not sure that a sister give potassium chloride 1 ml per kilo. Okay, so that's why it's an extremely important to have or to know that which potassium preparation you have in your unit. So when you're using a peripheral infusion, a potassium concentration not exceeding 40 milligrams per liter can be used. If you are using a central venous line, then a potassium concentration not exceeding 80 milligrams per liter should be infused. The rate of infusion should not exceed 0.5 to 1 milliequivalent per kilogram per hour for the fear of rebound hypokalemia. So how do we give this infusion? For a peripheral infusion, you take 2 ml of potassium chloride in 100 ml of fluids and infuse at a rate of 10 to 20 ml per kilo per hour. For central venous infusion, 4 ml of potassium chloride in 100 ml of IV fluids at a rate of 5 to 10 ml per kilo per hour. This rate will give infusion rate of potassium not more than 0.5 to 1 milliequivalent per kilo per hour. So the goal is to raise the potassium level by 0.3 to 0.5 milliequivalents per liter. And when you correct hypokalemia, please do not forget to monitor ECG and serial potassium levels, because the baby could have disturbance in ECG because of rebound hypokalemia. Treat the cause. Case 2, a female baby born at 28 weeks of gestation, was admitted, received surfactant, is on CPAP currently. She also was diagnosed to have PDA, was receiving ibuprofen for PDA. She was also on TPN. She started having apnea episodes and was taken on IPPO on day 5 of life. Her lab on day 5 showed CBC, which was normal in range. Septic screen was negative, sodium was 134 milliequivalents per liter, potassium was 8 milliequivalents per liter, creatinine was 2 milligrams per deciliter. USG brain was normal, chest X-ray, abdominal X-ray was normal. So what disturbance do we have here? This baby has potassium on higher side, the creatinine on higher side. This baby has kidney injury and high potassium, that is hyperkalemia. Hyper is high, kalemia is potassium. Any level more than 6 milliequivalent per liter for a neonate is abnormal. This baby also showed loss of P wave and tall peak P wave. The other abnormalities which can be seen based on the range of the potassium, it is widened QRS complex. Okay, so the level of potassium affects the ECG abnormality. But why this patient might have got hyperkalemia? Either the patient would have taken, either they would have been increased potassium intake through IV fluids or decreased potassium clearance through kidney, or there could be a transcellular movement of potassium. So we know the case, this is an extreme preterm receiving ibuprofen, lab report showing acute kidney injury and high potassium. Likely the renal failure is the reason for hypokalemia. So what's next? So once we know that the potassium is on a higher side and the clinical situation is not fitting the high level of potassium, confirm the report. Send non-hemolyzed arterial venous sample, but do not wait for starting the treatment. You start the treatment on urgent basis. When you decide to start the treatment, you decide urgency of the treatment. Prevent complications while you treat the patient and treat the cause. How do we decide urgency of the treatment? It is based on the level of potassium levels, the rapidity of the increase in potassium, and the presence of symptoms associated with hyperkalemia. If the baby is symptomatic and has high potassium levels, or the levels are more than 7 milliequivalent per liter in an asymptomatic neonate, or a neonate with serum potassium more than 6 milliequivalent per liter at risk of continued rise of potassium levels, these are the indication for starting emergent treatment. Non-emergent therapy is indicated in asymptomatic neonates with potassium levels of less than 7 milliequivalents per liter. When I'm saying emergent treatment, what does it constitute? It constitutes of calcium gluconate. You immediately secure the IV line, start calcium gluconate at the rate of 1 to 2 ml per kilogram to be given over 5 minutes. This calcium is going to stabilize the membrane potential, and thereby it may help in disturbance of the heart conduction abnormality as well as the contractility of the muscles. Glucose insulin drip is another emergent medication. So the dose which is advised is bolus of regular insulin, that is 0.05 units per kg and 2 ml per kg of 10% dextrose over 30 minutes, followed by 10% dextrose infusion at a rate of 2 to 4 ml per kilo per hour along with regular insulin 0.1 units per kg. Very confusing. Basically, take 10 units of regular insulin, put it in 100 ml of 10% dextrose and start the rate of 1 ml per kilogram per hour. That is glucose insulin drip. Once you start glucose insulin drip, do not forget to monitor blood glucose levels. Okay. IV soda bicarb is another emergent medication. However, it would be useful only in case of metabolic acidosis. If the baby does not have metabolic acidosis, bicarb is not going to help in transcellular shift of the potassium. The fourth medicine is nebulized salbutamol, which can be given in a dose of 400 microgram in 2 ml of normal saline every 2 hours for maximum 12 dosages. Its role in neonates is not yet clear, but this is one of the emergent treatment for managing hyperkalemia. Non-emergent medications are IV furosemide, 1 mg per kilogram, Cakesalate, that is potassium exchange resin, to be given in a dose of 1 gram per kilogram. How do we constitute? It is 1 gram of Cakesalate dissolved in 2 ml of normal saline, to be given rectally at a rate of 2 ml per kg through feeding tube inserted 2 to 3 cm. So follow the rule of 2. 1 gram dissolved in 2 ml of normal saline, give in a dose of 2 ml per kg in a feeding tube which is inserted up to 2 cm. Right? It can be given every 4th hourly. Peritoneal dialysis is always an option when there is a refractory hyperkalemia. When I'm saying emergent and non-emergent medications, it doesn't mean that I give emergent medications only in emergency situation and non-emergency emergent medical equipment reserve. No. When a baby is symptomatic or has severe hyperkalemia, you start with the emergent medications and side by side, you also need to start non-emergent medications. So this is a flow chart which is showing the management of a patient with hyperkalemia. A neonate when has hyperkalemia, symptomatic, send the potassium level, confirm the potassium level, start ECG monitoring, monitor vitals, start emergent therapy with calcium gluconate, glucose insulin drip, and beta adrenergic agent inhalation. Monitor the response in terms of serial lab testing of potassium and continuous ECG monitoring. If the patient responds well, good. Find out the cause. If the patient doesn't respond well, then you need to go for peritoneal dialysis. When you start the emergent therapy, side by side, you also start the non-emergent therapy. Thank you very much.